Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful today as we come into your house. Lord, what an awesome honor it is and privilege and blessing to be in your presence. God, lifting up your praise. God, having a good time singing to you, Lord, and laughing together. Lord, what a joy, what fun, God. Now, Lord, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther with you. We want to go deeper. We ask that as we open up your word, that you open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. God, we'll do our part. We'll give our interest and our attention, God. We know you'll do your part, Lord. So welcome in this place. God, truly, today we acknowledge that the teacher of the church is not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, God. Truly, the teacher of the church is the Holy Spirit. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for our brothers and sisters in the Lord that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, we bless them if they're lifting up the name of Jesus, preaching your gospel and your truth, God. We bless all of our brothers and sisters, God. We ask that you'd bless the Baptists, the Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. We thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, Oak Valley, for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, for Victory, Lord, for Crossroads, God, and God, for the Assemblies and the Four Square denominations. God, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters and Messianic Jewish brothers and sisters, God. If they're lifting up the name of Jesus, exalting you, preaching your gospel and your truth, God, we bless them as you would bless us. Also, God, we don't forget our brothers and sisters persecuted and scattered abroad the world, Lord. We ask that they would endure to the end and that you strengthen them and encourage them. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Today, get your Bibles out. Go with me to the book of Exodus, second book in the Bible, Exodus. We're going to be in chapter number 13, starting in verse number 1 and verse number 2. Like I mentioned, this is the blessed life. This is actually part number 3. Now, if you missed part number 1 and part number 2, I would encourage you, go online. We have them for free. You can watch the video. You can listen to the podcast, that sort of a thing. Download it on your smartphone or your device, whatever you need to do to get a hold of that message, or we have the CDs available for you. But that way, you can kind of refresh and get going on what we've already covered in this series. Just to review for a moment, part number 1, you remember we talked about, it's all about the heart. It starts with the heart. If we're going to live a blessed life, there has to be a heart that is in sync with the things of God. And it's all about the heart. It's not about your wallet, not about financial things per se, but really it starts with the heart. Then last time we were together, you remember Pastor Luke brought a brilliant message about what test? I didn't know there was a test. Well, what are we talking about here? And tithing is a test, yes, but tithing is also a blessing to our lives. Now today we're going to continue to build on those principles. And today the concept is this, the principle of the first. The principle of the first. Now, it may seem cliche, you may have heard this before, but really it applies to what we're talking about today. Here's the statement, first things first, right? You guys have heard that? First things first. See, when God is the first one in your life, when God takes the priority, when God is number one in your life, then everything else in your life will line up. Everything else will be taken care of. Now, don't get me wrong, it's still going to be a struggle, still going to be hard, you're still going to have to be diligent, still going to have to put your interest and your attention, put hard work and effort, there's still going to be sorrows and troubles along the way. But if God is number one, he's going to work it out. He's going to take care of you. He will bless you. But if God is not number one, we got problems, don't we? See, because when you have something like your marriage, if you put your spouse above God, eventually, you're going to be worshiping your spouse, and God will be out of your life. Your marriage is not going to be the way that it should be. Things are going to be out of order. If you place your children above God, your children eventually won't serve God. Why? Because they won't see the priority on God, and they'll just go serving themselves because they have always been the priority. In business, if you put your business, your finances above God, eventually, they will squash God out of your life. Why? Because you cannot serve two masters, the Bible says. Therefore, God must be number one. First things first. God is the priority of our lives. Let's take a look at the principle in the Word of God. Exodus chapter 13, verse number 1 and verse number 2 say this. Exodus chapter 13, starting in verse number 1. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, verse number 2, consecrate to me. Now, hold on for a second. Consecrate, what does that mean? That means to set apart for a holy purpose. Okay? To set apart for a holy or exclusive purpose. So God says, consecrate to me all the firstborn. Everybody say firstborn. Okay, you got to play with me today, okay? This is an interactive message. You're not going to sit there like a bump on a log, all right? You got to play with me today, okay? So I need everybody to say firstborn. Firstborn. There you are. Consecrate to me all the firstborn, whatever opens the womb among the children of Israel, both man and beast, it is mine. I want you to know something. God says, first things first, the first is mine. Why? Because God is first. God has the priority. God is numero uno, right? So therefore, God says, consecrate, set aside for my holy purpose, my exclusive purpose, the firstborn. Okay? Drop down, if you will, to verse number 12 and verse number 13. Look at what he says in verse number 12, that you shall set apart to the Lord all that open the womb. That is every firstborn. Everybody say firstborn. That comes from an animal, which you have, the male shall be the Lord's. Verse 13. But every firstborn, everybody say firstborn. Firstborn of a donkey, you shall redeem with a lamb. And if you will not redeem it, then you shall break its neck. And all the firstborn of man among your sons you shall redeem. Okay, now everything in the Bible speaks to us today. Sometimes people look at the Old Testament and they say, oh, you can throw that out. That no longer applies. We're in the New Testament. We're under grace. We don't need that any longer. And yet, that's a very foolish and immature approach to the Word of God, because Jesus came and he told the Pharisees, you guys search the scriptures that are speaking of me. Now, we understand the Old Testament was saved for an example to us of how we're to live today. That's where the terms types and shadows, have you ever heard types and shadows used in the Bible? There was a type. Think about a typewriter, right? The typewriter had hammers on it, and those hammers had an image, but the image was backwards. And as the ink was applied to that hammer and it would hit the paper, right, bang, all of a sudden you would have the true image of whatever that character was. Same thing with a shadow. Think about a shadow for a second. The shadow is the form and the image of the substance, okay? So let's say you were having a picnic at the park and you saw the shadow of an airplane coming at you. You would look and you would say, oh, there's an airplane flying around somewhere. And if that shadow started coming towards your little picnic area, you wouldn't run in terror, right? Ah, plane, no! Why? Because the shadow has no power to take you anywhere or to do anything to you. It's the substance. Now, if you saw a plane coming at you, different story. But the shadow you look at and you can tell, okay, because I see a shadow, there's a substance. Same thing with the Bible. The Old Testament, all of the scriptures point to Jesus. So when you see the shadow in the Old Testament, it's speaking of Jesus, the substance in the New Testament, and this is where we live today. So what does he say? He says that you are to consecrate all of the firstborn. And it talks of clean and of unclean animals, okay? So the image that we get is that of a lamb. A lamb was a clean animal. All the firstborn lambs, the males, were the Lord's, and they were to be sacrificed, okay? So then you see the image of the unclean. The unclean was a donkey, right? And he says, the unclean must be redeemed. That brings us to point number one for today. The firstborn must be sacrificed or redeemed. Okay? If we're going to take a look at the principle of the first in the Bible, the firstborn must be sacrificed or be redeemed. Let's take a look at the image. We were born unclean. Is that right? See, we were born into sin. All of us have a terminal blood disease that was given to us at birth called sin. It was passed on from our father, Adam, the first man. And through one man, sin entered the world, and therefore all sinned. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it there based on your goodness, based on your own merit. You were unclean when you were born. Therefore, you had to be redeemed. Now, Jesus was born of a virgin, born in the fullness of time, right? Born under the law. But he came, and when John the Baptist saw Jesus, what did he say? He said, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. See, Jesus is the only one who could qualify to be the perfect, spotless, sinless Lamb. He is the only begotten of God, the firstborn. And therefore, God gave Jesus his firstborn, and because he was clean, he had to be sacrificed for us who were unclean, who had to be redeemed. Are you listening? Us donkeys. Come on, somebody. Look at your neighbor and say, did he just call me a... Yes, yes I did. Called myself one too. What is the principle? Principle is this, that when we give our first, when we give our tithe, that 10% right off the top, We are giving it like God did. See, God modeled this for us in Jesus. He gave Jesus before we were ever fruitful. Are you listening? He gave Jesus while we were still in sin. He redeemed us in faith, believing and knowing that eventually we would give our heart and life to him. We would be redeemed. We would receive the Lord, and we would become fruitful in our lives. Think about the farmer who was out there with his crops, and he's giving the first fruits, the most valuable part of his first fruits, to God. He didn't know if he was going to have more crops. He didn't know if he was going to be more fruitful. Well, what about the shepherd who's sacrificing the lamb that was born? He didn't know if that sheep was going to have another lamb that he could keep. He was sacrificing that lamb in faith, giving his very livelihood to God, putting it all on the line in faith. See, God gave Jesus before we were fruitful. In the same way, we bring our tithe believing that God is going to make us fruitful, believing that we'll be blessed. That's the principle that we see. And even if we don't tithe, let's say we say, well, you know what? I don't really know. I can't really trust God. Therefore, I'm going to keep it for myself. Listen, you're going to lose it anyways. Why? Because the principle. Remember, if you will not redeem the donkey, you'll break its neck. What you don't redeem, what you don't give to God, you're going to lose anyways. So you might as well give it. Hello? It's okay. You don't have to like me. Which brings us to the second thing, is that the first fruit must be offered. The first fruit must be offered. You're there in Exodus. Turn over to chapter number 23. Exodus chapter number 23 and verse number 19. Now we're going to take a look at just the first part of this verse, because the second part of this verse, the second sentence, is another message for another day. All right? But the first sentence says this. Exodus chapter 23, verse number 19. Look at what he says. The first of the first fruits of your land you shall bring into the house of the Lord your God. The first of the first fruits. Everybody say the first. Now say of the first fruits. Oftentimes when we think of offerings to God, especially when it comes to the Old Testament, we think of the blood. It's the lamb. It's the blood. It's the lamb. It's the blood. So that's all that it is. And Jesus is that image now in the New Testament. We think that, okay, Jesus paid it all. Jesus gave it all. Therefore, I don't have to give anything. But yet God is saying, not just the blood, not just the sacrifice now, but the first of the first fruits of your land, you shall bring into where? The house of the Lord your God. You know what the house of God is? The Bible describes it for us. It is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. Remember, Jacob came and he had an experience with God. Heaven was opened up over him. He saw the ladder, angels ascending and descending upon it. That's a picture of Christ in the New Testament, right? And so we see that Jacob met up with him. He says, this is none other than the house of God. This is Beth El. The house of God. What is that? That's the place where you meet up with God. That's the place where you connect with God. That's the place that when you come together corporately, the heavens open up and God starts to speak to you and pour out his wisdom to you. That's where you get your God connection. That's where your divine destiny is linked up with. Therefore, he says, the first of your first fruits of your land you shall bring to the house of the Lord your God. Proverbs chapter 3, verse number 9 says this, honor the Lord with your possessions. See, we come to God and we say, God, I do honor you. I love you, Lord. You take first place, but God, don't touch my wallet. But God is saying, if you're really linked up with me, where your treasure is, there your heart will be, right? Also. Where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. So honor the Lord, not just with lip service, not just with the mental assent, honor the Lord with your possessions, because that's going to reveal where your heart is truly at. And with the first fruits, everybody say first fruits, of all your increase. So as the Lord blesses you, as you get that paycheck, as you get the increase into your life, he says, I want you to honor the Lord with the first fruits. Take that tithe and give it to God. Now, lest we think that God is all about himself or just all about the church or just all about the pastors, God gave us the next verse, verse number 10. Let's take a look at it together. So whose barns? God's barns? The church's barns. Pastor Dan's barns. So your barns will be filled with just a little bit. So your barns will be filled with just enough so that you can scrape by this week. I'm sorry, does your Bible say that? So your barns will be filled with plenty. And your vats will have a couple drops of wine in them. A little dabble, do you? Oh, a good amount and a little bit extra so that you can share with someone else. Is that what that says? No, your vats will overflow with new wine. See, God is not just interested in lining the pockets of the pastor or the church just prospering. No, God is interested in every single one of you prospering. God wants your vats to overflow with new wine. See, when your cup runneth over, the table gets blessed. Come on, somebody. God, okay, I got enough. Lord, you can turn, wait, God, I know I'm under the spout where the glory pours out, but God, it's too much, Lord. I'm so blessed. I've just been overtaken, God. I'm drowning in the blessing, Lord. Come on. But you got to honor the Lord with your possessions. That's where that starts. See, tithing is the trigger that opens and unlocks the blessings in your life. It's a starting place. Remember, it's a test for our lives. That's where it all starts. We're going to live the blessed life. We've got to make sure that we honor the Lord. See, God says to bring it. You know why God says to bring it? Because you can't give what's not yours. You just have to bring it. You're a steward, if you remember. You can only bring it or you can steal it. Let me say that again. You can only bring it or you can steal it. See, because if it's not yours and you hold on to it, you have just stolen. Malachi, the third chapter, you remember this. Shall a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. In what way, God? In what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. See, you can only bring it or you can steal it. We're just stewards bringing to the Lord what's already his. Joshua chapter number 7 talks about Achan. You remember Achan, right? What happened? The children of Israel, here they come into the promised land. God says, I want you to march around Jericho. Jericho is going to be the first city that you take down. Fortified city, huge walls. March around it 7 days, 7 times, right? The seventh time on the seventh day, I want you to lift up a shout to the Lord and God will bring the walls a tumbling down. But I don't want you to take any of the spoil of Jericho. That is the first fruits of the land that is consecrated unto the Lord. It's holy. And therefore, all of that spoil, all the gold, all the silver that you could have collected for yourselves, I want you to give that to the Lord in faith, believing that God's going to continue to prosper and bless you in the land. So what do? They go out, they march around 7 days, seventh time on the seventh day, they march around, they give a shout to the Lord. The walls come a tumbling down. You remember the story of Rahab. She's the only one that's saved. Everyone else, they slaughter, right? The edge of the sword, man and beast. All of the spoil goes to the Lord. Now it's time for them to go to the next city. Next city, little teeny tiny city called Ai. Right? Little name, little city. And so here they go up against Ai and they say, listen, we don't need to send everybody out and wear them all out marching down there. Just send a couple of guys down there. Let them take care of business and they can come back and we'll go on to the next city. So they go down to this little city called Ai and what happens? They get whipped. Just completely. They come running. They're fleeing before their enemies. Joshua and the whole nation, right? They put on the ashes, they put on the sackcloth, they tear their clothes. Joshua's before the Ark of the Covenant, face down on the ground, and he starts to pray and he says, Lord, what have you done bringing us out here to be overtaken by our enemies? Surely the Canaanites are going to hear about this. They're going to surround us and wipe our name off from before the earth. Then what's going to be happening with your great name? Now, I believe that the Lord probably was listening up until that point where Joshua started talking about God's name. And God says, wait, shut up. I'm paraphrasing now. He says, stand up like a man. Listen to what I have to say to you. Someone has taken the accursed things. Now remember, before it was consecrated, now that it's been stolen, it's cursed. Remember, this is the principle of the first. When you consecrate it, when you give it to the Lord, it's holy. It's blessed. But if you keep it, it's cursed. Might as well break its neck. So he says, someone's taken, and tomorrow I want you to consecrate the nation to me. We're going to go tribe by tribe, clan by clan, and then man by man. We're going to find out who did this. And so there they go, tribe of Judah, right? Then they got the clan. Then they finally come to the family. Then they start going man by man. All of a sudden, Achan is taken. He steps forward, and they say, give glory to God. What have you done? He says, it's there in my tent. Go check it out. They go, and they find the silver. They go, and they find the gold. They go, and they find the accursed things that he took that were consecrated to the Lord before. And so what happens? They have to stone him, his whole family, all of his livestock, all of his animals, everything that he has. They pile it up in a heap. They burn it all with fire, and then they heap stones over it to remember what happened. Why? Because it was a principle of the first. The first belongs to God. He is the Lord. It's his. It's his. Remember in the book of Genesis. Praise the Lord. You can give God a hand clap. It's all right. Remember in the book of Genesis, if you want to turn there with me, Genesis chapter number 4, Cain and Abel, right? You remember this a couple months ago, we were in this in the book of Hebrews talking about the sacrifices that were brought, about worship to the Lord, what that was all about. Genesis chapter 4, starting verse number 3, it says, "And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord." Now, I want you to notice something. He was a tiller of the ground. And it says, in the process of time, or in the fullness of time, he brought an offering of the ground to the Lord. Now, did you notice the word first up there? Anybody notice the word first? No. Okay, let's read on. Let's read on. Verse number 4. Abel, his brother, also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering. Verse 5, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry and his countenance fell. Now, you remember the rest of the story. He goes on to murder his brother. But the point of what we're talking about today is notice the principle of the first fruits. Cain just brings an offering in the fullness of time. And yet Abel brings of the firstborn of his flock. See, there's a principle of the first. Could that be why the Lord respected Abel's offering and not Cain's offering? I think so. And therefore, he was angry. See, God does not take second place. You know, God knows everything. And God knows he's first. But he's not an egotist. It's just that he should be. He's the creator of all things. He's the Alpha. He's the first. He's the preeminent one, if you will. And therefore, think about it this way. God's ways are higher than our ways. God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Is that right? That means that God has never realized anything. Isn't that just bake your noodle? God was never sitting around going, you know, I wonder. I get it. I see what I did there. No. God already knew. Therefore, when God says the first is mine, God knows what he's doing. He's not being mean. He's not trying to put you down. He knows the plan. He knows how he's going to bless you. He's all-knowing, all-seeing, all-powerful. He is everywhere all at once. Therefore, when God says, give me the first and trust me with the rest, God already knows how he's going to bless you. God already knows the provision. God is the one who put the principle into play. Therefore, when God is asking you to give, it's not so that you'll lack, it's so that you'll have. God wants to bless you. Which brings us to the last thing for today is that the tithe must be first. The tithe must be first. Now, keep your finger in Exodus 13. We'll come back there in a moment. But Leviticus chapter 27, playing around the Old Testament today. Leviticus chapter number 27, right there before you hit Numbers. Leviticus chapter 27, right towards the end, we're going to take a look at verse number 30. Leviticus chapter 27, verse number 30 says this, "And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord." Now remember, holy means exclusively his. God says the firstborn must be sacrificed or redeemed. First fruits must be brought into the house of the Lord. And the tithe is holy to the Lord. The tithe belongs to God. See, when we give the first part, the rest gets blessed. The Apostle Paul in the book of Romans says, if the little portion is blessed, then the whole lump is holy. The principle applies to our life too. Let me illustrate this for you. God must be first, right? Okay, so let's say you're a business owner, all right? Everybody in the room is now a business owner. Congratulations, okay? So you start to bid a job. You bid out all your materials. You bid out all of your costs. You bid out all of your supplies. You bid out all of your labor, okay? And then you work in there a profit, right? You go, you do the job, you get paid, you pay out all of your expenses from that, and then your increase comes in. Finally, you get a check. Let's say you get a check. Your increase is $1,000. Okay, so you get that check of $1,000, you endorse it, and you go down to the bank. You say, I'd like to cash this check. Okay, you lay it down there, and they say, okay, $1,000, right? So here's what they do. They take out a stack of bills, and they say, $1,000, okay, I'm going to give it to you in hundreds. Okay, and they lay out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 $100 bills in front of you. Now I'm going to ask you two questions. Okay, first one's easy, second one's a little bit harder, okay? Now, first question is this. How much is a tithe on that $1,000? $100, right? Okay, so one of those hundreds is a tithe to the Lord? Here's the second question. Which one of those hundreds is the tithe? The first one. I knew you were going to say that because we're talking about the principle of the first, right? And you're right, but you're also wrong. Here's why. Is that the one on the left, the first one? Or is that the one on the right, the first one? Oh, okay. Let me illustrate it to you this way. All right, let me tell you a story. My wife and I, we're in Bible college, right? We're going to Bible college. We've got our little jobs that we're doing. We're working at the big box warehouse store, and we're scraping by. Yeah, we got support coming in for tuition, that sort of a thing, and we've got our bills, and so we're paying our bills on time. We got our rents, you know, we got our groceries, we got our car payments, all that kind of stuff. We're keeping up with things. We're giving into the building fund here at the church. Come on, somebody, okay? And so we're putting first things first. We think in our minds. And so we're going to Bible class, we're doing life, and you know, every time we would do the bills and that sort of thing, we have about $20 left over. Now, for college students, you can do that, right? Because we'd go down to Taco Bueno, and we would get the little meal, you know, for $5 and share that meal, and then we would go to the dollar show, and so we'd pay about, like, you know, $7 and have maybe $13 left over for the month, okay? Scraping by, that's not a lot to live on. And so there was no extras. Everything was calculated. Everything was planned. Everything. So we go and we go to this finance class. Now we think we're pretty cool with finances. And so the instructor says, I want you guys all to create a budget. I want you to list down all of your expenses. I want you to list down your income versus expenses, then draw the line at the bottom. And then I want you to show what you have left over at the end and show how you're going to do, what you're going to do with that overflow. You know, are you going to put it in savings? You put it in retirement? What are you going to do with that? So we go home. We sit down. You know, they're in the computer, at the computer, you know, in the office, which is also slash bedroom, also slash everything else, right? And so, college students, right? A little apartment. So we sit down and we start to write everything out. And as we write everything down, you know, we got our income up here, you know, here's both of our income together, here's support, here's bills that we're paying, all that kind of stuff. We got the tithe there, and then we draw the line at the bottom, and we look down there, and we are in the negative. We cannot afford to live. Now, that was pretty shocking to us. We looked at each other and we're like, what are we going to do? You know, we're in the negative. Maybe we're foolish. Maybe we need to change something here. What's going on? And so we must have done something wrong. So we crumble up that paper, throw it away, right? And we do it again. Income, here's all of our expenses. Here's the tithe. We draw the line and we go down. And down at the bottom, we are still in the negative. And I think it went from bad to worse. We forgot a bill in there or something. So we said, okay. Something's wrong here. Something's going on. God, you've been so gracious to us. Thank God we're tithers because, you know, we still got the $20 left over. Somehow God's working it out. Now, we could have been content to sit there and say, oh, look at this. Praise God. We can't make it, but we're still making it. We got $20 left over. Yay. And yet something was bugging us. So we took it to prayer and we said, God, there's something going on here. We shouldn't be making it. We're in the negative, and something's wrong, God, and we don't know what it is. Lord, would you just open our eyes and show us what it is that's going on here? And God says, I want you to take the tithe at the bottom of that sheet of paper, and I want you to put it up at the top of that sheet of paper. And we said, whoa, God, I'm sorry. Please forgive us. We've had our priorities out of line. And so we crumbled up that paper. We threw it out right at the top. Income, that's our increase, right at the top. First order of business, number one, tithe in big, bold, capital letters, tithe, right? Then all of our expenses, gas, electricity, rents, car payment, you know, church building fund, all that kind of stuff. And down, we drew the line at the bottom, and we calculated it all up, and you know what happened? We were still in the negative. The math doesn't change, guys. What changed was where we had put our priorities. You know, after that, we didn't just have $20 in the bank. It was $40, $60. Sometimes it was $100. Oh, honey, no more Taco Bueno. We're going to the sit-down restaurant. Woo! Still going to go to the dollar show because that's a good deal. You know what I'm saying? But God says he must be first. God says that he must have the priority, and the tithe belongs to the Lord. When you hold on to it, my goodness, I would rather have 90% blessed than 100% cursed. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'll close with this. Exodus chapter 13 once again. Exodus chapter 13. We're going to take a look at verse number 14 and verse number 15. Exodus chapter 13, starting in verse number 14. It says, so it shall be when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what is this? That you shall say to him, by strength of hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And it came to pass, when Pharaoh was stubborn about letting us go, that the Lord killed all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both the firstborn of man and the firstborn of beast. Therefore, I sacrifice to the Lord all males that open the womb, but all the firstborn of my sons I redeem. In other words, think about this for a second. Put yourself in ancient Israel. You're a shepherd. You're running the business, and you start getting your kids involved, and your son is your accountant. One day, you come in from a long day's work, and your son is sitting there, and he says, Dad, I've been looking over the books, and we need to talk. We've had a great year. It's been wonderful. But I notice every time there's a firstborn male lamb, you go and you get the knife. And Dad, you're killing some of our profits. And you sit down and you say, son, let me work this out for you. Let me tell you about something. There was a time when our people were enslaved. We were in bondage to the Egyptians. Moses came as God's deliverer for us and he said, let my people go. And yet Pharaoh hardened his heart against the Lord. He was stubborn and he wouldn't let us go. Therefore, God killed all the firstborn of Egypt and all the firstborn of the beasts. And yet he spared Israel and he delivered us with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, because God has redeemed us, because God has brought us out of slavery, therefore, I give to God my first and I give to God my best in faith, believing that God is going to bless and prosper us. You know, we've seen this play out with our children. We have three wonderful, beautiful children. And I remember there were times where they'd get a birthday card, open up the birthday card, $10, you know, to a five-year-old, that's like all the money in the world. Oh my goodness, what can I do with $10? And so we would take that $10 and we would say, honey, this is so wonderful. This is so great. $10. Did you say thank you? Yes, you did. Okay, good. Good. Good boy, good girl. Now, one of those dollars belongs to the Lord. And that's called a tithe. You know, at first they would just accept that. Okay. Dollar belongs to the Lord. That's tithe. Okay, I'm going to bring it to church. And they drop it in the offering and be happy about it. But after a while, they start to grow older, 7, 8, 9 years old. And all of a sudden, we're saying, yay, $10. One of those belongs to the Lord. Now, hold on a second. You're cutting into my toy money. Why are we doing this, Dad? We sit them on our laps and we say, you know, there was a time when mom and dad weren't serving the Lord. The time when we were in bondage, we were enslaved to sin. And yet God's been so good to us. God loves us so much, and God asks for a tithe of all of our increase. Therefore, I tithe. I give the first, and I give the best to God. And is Daddy blessed? Oh, yeah, Daddy, you're blessed. Is Mommy blessed? Yeah, we're rich, aren't we? Yeah, we're rich. Not by the world's standards, but by a godly standard. We're blessed. And our children say that I'm going to give too. That's what this is all about, the blessed life. What did we learn today? We learned a couple of things about the tithe. First of all, this, first things first. Firstborn must be sacrificed or redeemed. Second thing is this, the first fruit must be offered. And final, the tithe must be first. So you guys get something from the word of the Lord today? Just take a moment right where you're at. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want you to just think for a moment. What is God speaking to you? Just take a private moment with the Lord and listen for his voice. What is God speaking to you? Some of you, God's telling you you need to tithe. It's time to start. It's time to honor him. Maybe the Lord's speaking to you that he's not the first place and you need to reorder your list. What's God speaking to you? Now take a moment. I want you to write that down. I want you to type it out on your phone or your mobile device so that you'll remember it. Now you're accountable to it. Now just take a moment in prayer and commit that to the Lord. God, yes. Say yes. Yes, Lord, I will. God, I'll step out in faith. God, I'll believe you. God, I'm going to bring the tithe. Please forgive me, God, of holding on to it. Lord, it's yours. I don't want to rob you, God. Forgive me, God, of having misplaced priorities. God, I put my kids or the sports or whatever it is above you, God. Lord, I'm putting you at the top. You're number one, God. You always were anyways. I'm just getting myself in line with you, Lord. Let's commit that to the Lord. Husbands and wives, maybe you want to whisper in each other's ears what God is speaking to you so that now you're accountable to one another. Let's take a moment and do that right now. Tell your spouse, God just spoke this to me. We're going to do this. Praise God. Everybody look up. Put a smile on your face. God is good. All right, can we praise the Lord today? Hallelujah. I want to talk to some of you guys before we leave this place. It's been a great day. You guys have been awesome. Thank you for your hearts. Thank you guys for your interest and your attention. I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart's right with God and that if you died, that you didn't go to hell, but that you would go to heaven. That doesn't just happen just because you sit in church. Can I love you enough to tell you the truth right now? Can we be honest with each other for a moment, not play games? You know, can someone please tell us the truth? Here's the truth. Hell is a very real place. Jesus talked about it. Old New Testament talks about it. It's real. Okay? God doesn't want you to go there. Neither do I, and neither do you. And yet, the Lord loves us enough to give us the free will choice while we're here on the earth, to choose where we go, whether heaven or whether hell. You know, he could have created a bunch of robots that serve him and say, I love you, but that would be empty. God wanted real heart. God wanted real life. Therefore, he gives us the opportunity while we're here to choose where we go, whether heaven or hell. Now, I got to say this because there's thinking out there that all roads lead to heaven. But can I tell you the truth? Not all roads lead to heaven. It's like saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want and you're never going to make it. It's only one way you're going to get to the moon. The same way, God doesn't say in the Bible that, you know, just do whatever you want to do. You think after God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son, beaten, bloody mess, hung on the cross, public spectacle for all to see. You think after he does all that, he says, yeah, just whatever you want to do and they want to do and they can do their thing. It's all cool. It's all good. You know, just do your thing and I'll see you in heaven. No, the Bible says that the road is narrow. There are few who find it. And yet it's very clear all throughout the scripture. Now, you might be thinking, well, I get that, Pastor, because I've been a good person. I was doing that so that I could get to heaven. Been working on my resume. It used to be bad. Now I cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. Doesn't that mean that I'm going to get to heaven? Do you know that nowhere in the Bible say how good you have to be? In fact, the standard is perfection if you're going to get to heaven by your good works. We talked about this today. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it there just by being good. Can't just do enough. And that'll get you there. Have your good outweigh your bad, or give money to charities, be nice to your neighbors, and God sees that and appreciates that and says, oh, I guess I'll let them in. They've been good enough. Listen, the standard's perfection. Not going to make it just by being good. Sometimes people think, well, I was raised in church. Parents told me we're Christians growing up. Hung a cross for St. Christopher around your neck. You say, Pastor, at my last church, I got involved, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church, even got a membership card. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Show that to me in the Bible, though, with your church involvement. Parents raised you in church, tell you Christian growing up. They get you to heaven. They have you baptized a Christian as a child, wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, Sunday school, Sabbath school, catechism class. Not there. Nowhere in the Bible say that because you get involved and you carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions, sing in the choir, or that you get a membership card and now all of a sudden God was waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter. Doesn't work like that. Today, let me love you, respect you, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. Say, but Pastor, I know God. I believe. We were singing that song today. I believe in God the Father. I believe in God the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three. And I understand that. I believe it. Doesn't that? Isn't there a scripture about that? Yeah, there is. Yeah, there is. But before I get there and explain that to you, think about this for a second. The demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Are they Christians? No. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet does that qualify him for heaven? No. And yet we think because we understand up here with our heads a mental ascent towards God and know who Jesus is or can quote some scripture, that that makes us all right with God. You say, but what about that scripture? Think about what the scripture says for a moment, that if you confess with your mouth and you believe where? In your heart, not just in your head. And it says in verse next couple of verses that you have to believe, not only believe and accept it and acknowledge it as true, but you have to believe unto righteousness. Not just the imputed righteousness of God, but also the righteousness of your actions changing and lining up with him. So you can't just say, I believe in God and that's enough. It has to come from the heart. In fact, Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, we don't like that. We think that's weird. We've seen that in movies, Hollywood, television, books, and the internet. But come on, guys, let's not let society define for us biblical things. Let's let the Bible do that for us. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to the church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Those are pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. What's he saying? Lukewarm. What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down. A little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, I'm not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Now, Jesus said it like this. He said, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But he also said, if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. You can sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right. You've made your decision. Or you can give God all of your heart and all of your life. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. Here's your opportunity. I'll go one, two, three. And when I say three, I'll pop my hands together just like this. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all of my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Remember, if you confess me before man, you say, whoa, 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 whoa. Wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that today. Think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Yet the devil thinks you're dumb enough that he's going to talk you out of it right now. Oh, you don't have to do it. Just sit there and do nothing. Nah, it's a bunch of hooey. Now listen, you tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God today. Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. And guess what? All of us have done this at one point or another, one way or another in our life. Now it's your turn. We're all rooting you on. We're excited for you. No one's criticizing, judging, or condemning. We want to make sure that you have that same opportunity and that you take advantage of it today. Will you give God all your heart? Will you give God all your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand? If you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I describe it. You ready to get your hand up in this safe and friendly church? All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer down at the Love Rock Cafe. Come on, put the burger down. Get ready to get your hand up. And you can tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service if you're close by. Also online, wherever you're at around the world, God sees, God's watching right where you're at too. And you can raise your hand right there and then minimize your browser and click the blue button that says respond to God or go to our homepage, How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Six. Thank you. God bless you. Where are you at? Come on, lift them up high for me. Six. Where are you at? Seven up top. Got you over there. Seven, eight, nine. Thank you. God bless you. Nine. Where are you at? Just raise it up. Give me a little wave if I don't see you yet. Nine, 10. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you on this side. Who else? 10, 11 up there. 12 in the family room. Got you over there. There's a dozen wise people. If I already saw your hand, you can put it down. If I didn't yet see you, thank you. 13. God bless you. Who else today? Who else today? Just lift up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Who else today? About 13 wise people. 13, 14. Got you right there. Thank you. Over here again. Got you over there. 15. Thank you. God bless you. 15 wise people. Who else? Anybody else? I'm looking over here because there's a lot of people over here. Sinners must all sat on this side today. Here's the righteous seating. Come on. If you need to give God all your heart and all of your life, where are you at? Anybody else real quick I did not already see? Oh my goodness, another one over here, 16. The whole section over here is getting saved. Anybody else real quick? About 16 wise people. Anybody else? I'm going to wrap this up in a moment. You're going to miss this. Don't miss this. Come on. You've missed enough in your life. Now it's time to go on with God. Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you, 17. One last look. Man, I'm just fishing. 17. I'm on 18. If that's you, just lift up your hands. Where are you at, number 18? You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Come on, I know you're out there. Just lift it up. Just release it to the Lord right now. Let gravity take over and let your hand fall up. Anybody else, real quick? 17 wise people already. Number 18, come on, pop it up for me. That's you. That's you. Come on, go for it. Go for it. Quickly, I want to wrap this up. Everybody's waiting on you, but the Lord is holding this off because he loves you so much. Anybody else? This is it. I promise. One last sweep. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 17 wise people. Hallelujah. God is so good. All right, all 17 of you are number 18, you little rascal, you rebel. Here's what I want you to do. It's not too late. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get your stuff, in other words. Whatever you brought with you to church, get a friend if you need a friend. We're all going to stand and give a clap and a shout. As we do, that's your cue. Get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So that's you. You raise your hand. You should have raised your hand. Let's all stand and welcome them. You come right now. Come on down to the front. Just make your way to the front. Let's give them a hand.
Even God our Father.
They're coming. Come on. You can come too.
Even Christ the Son.
From the family rooms, you can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down.
Our God is three in one.
Come on. They're still coming.
Even the resurrection.
From the foyer, come on in. If you raised your hand out there.
Again, for I believe in the name
come on.
Of Jesus.
This is your time. This is your moment.
God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy
Spirit. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. They're still coming. They're still coming. You can come too. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. Say, come on, friend, I'll go with you. Hey, all right, you guys. Thank God you guys have come. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on, okay? He's going to do three things. I'll let you know what they are in advance. First thing he's going to do is lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. Second thing he's going to do, give you some free information, some free literature, tell you about a program we have here that'll help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. And then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Now listen, give us 1 year. Sitting consistently under the teaching here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center, okay? If you do that, I'm going to make a promise to you guys. Promise that after that year and for the rest of your life, you will look around and say, my goodness, I am so blessed. I did not know it could be this good. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it, okay? You guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give them a hand as they go. Woo! Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.